And my name is Melvin. I work in an organization called Quest Alliance. So we have been working with various ITIs across India on employability skills. Today I'm here to talk about labor legislation, especially on two important laws, that is about Factories Act and PF Act. So yeah. Let's see. Hopefully, all of you can see my screen. So, before we begin, I'd like to also point out a few things. There is a lot of content on. One second, someone is. Yeah. On Bharat Skills, which you can also access. And also. Quest app, which is developed by Quest Alliance, and we put up content for ITI students and for ITI students also various we also invite a lot of people to come and talk on the app, so this is also interesting platform. So quickly to move on to some norms for the session. We respect everyone who's in the call. And if you have any questions, you can put in the comment section and maybe you can take it forward. Let's not try to have any crosstalk during the session. And let's not have any harassment just for the safety of everyone who's participating in this call. So in this session, we'll be having focusing on two important law, that is Factories Act 1948 and Employees Provident Fund Act, which is initiated in 1952. So before we begin, I'd like to play a small video. Let's all take a look at it and then we'll come back.
Thank you.
So hopefully all of you are able to watch the video. So basically this video is very interesting to the topic that we're going to discuss today, about the Factories Act. So in this video, if you noticed, it's from a movie called Modern Times, by Charlie Chaplin, and a lot of connect is there for the session that we want to discuss in next 1 hour. So I'll just dive into the topic. So the main objective of this act is to protect any exploitation and unhygienic works which happens in the factory. Basically, this, if you noticed in the video also, there were a lot of places where the workers were exploited. To avoid this, this act was initiated. That is one main reason. And another main reason is also to improve the working condition for the workers. So those who work in the factories, how to improve their working condition. These are the two main aspects of that, and also there are a lot of objectives, but I just made it into these 2 points so that we are all aware about what are we talking about. So before we go into the act, I wanted to point a few things that you should keep in mind. So when I'm talking about whatever concepts that I'm talking about, in the point of view of the Factories Act. I'm not talking about anything that is happening in the real world. So what is this law talks about? That is what we will be talking about. So in this, who is a worker? There are three types of people who come across that the law defines. One is anyone who is less than 15 years old is called a child. Between the age group of 15 to 18 years old is called young person, or they also called adolescent. Third person who is more than 18 years old are the workers. So child cannot be working under any in the factories or industries, but a young person can be worked, but not under hazardous process. Let's talk about what is this hazardous process, but that is the law is talking about. Next, what is a factory? According to this law, what does a factory mean? Factory is nothing but anything that is any persons who are employed more than 10 or more which uses power and manufacturing process are called factory. That is one type of factory. Another type of factory is if there are employees who are workers who are more than 20 and plus manufacturing process without power also is called a factory. So we can see many examples for that. For example, imagine there's a small workshop, and if it has more than 10 workers you are employing, then you will be coming under this law. Or if you have with a use of power, that means if you are using any electricity, if you are using any power consumption, then it means that you are under this law. That is one definite example. Another one is if there are more than 20, but you don't use power, but still use manpower, which has more than 20, then also you have come under this law. So what is this hazardous process? Hazardous process is nothing but anything that involves danger, anything that involves a lot of heavy work. Those are termed as hazardous process, and anything that is produced from raw materials into finished goods are called manufacturing process. This is definition of manufacturing process according to this law. So these are few things that we should keep in mind before going forward. So if you have seen in the video, there were a lot of things that they were talking about. We will be focusing on three more important things. One is working hours. Another one is welfare. Another one is health and safety. This law talks about all three aspects. What is working hours? What is welfare? What is health and safety? We will be talking in detail about all these three things. So, yeah. Working hours. So basically, our you can work in a factory. That is what. Once again, I am muting someone. Yeah. So working hours. So in this, no adult worker shall be required or allowed to work in a factory for more than 48 hours in a week. So any person can't work more than 48 hours in a week. That means if a person works more than 48 hours, that person will get something called overtime pay, or in short, we can call it as OT. Then weekly holidays, no adult worker shall be required or allowed to work in a factory on first day of the week. That we will talk about this in detail. Or yes, or will have holiday for a whole day. So let's see with an example what does this means. Imagine the first day of the week is Sunday, and it has to be an holiday. And you, if you see, we'll be working Monday to Saturday at least. So if we work from Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday should be the next holiday. And if Sunday is not an holiday, for example, if the company asks you to work on Sunday, then you should get a holiday within the next 3 days, that is before 3 days or after 3 days. For example, if you ask to work on Sunday and you are supposed to take an holiday on, that is previously, that is Thursday, Friday, Saturday, or Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. So that is another important law that this law talks about. Next one is compensatory holiday. If any factory is exempted from any provision, employer is deprived of any of the weekly holidays, which provision is made. So if it is your right to ask for compensatory holiday if you have worked for any of these days. For example, if you are supposed to get an holiday on Sunday and if you're not, and you are supposed to get a holiday on any of these 3 days, that is before the day of 3 days before or 3 days after. So if you're not getting a compensatory holiday for the work you have done, which is supposed to be an holiday, then it is offense. You can ask for it. So that is your right. So minimum of 9 hours you are supposed to work. So that is another important thing that the law is talking about. On a minimum 9 hours you can work, and if a company or a factory asks you to work more than 9 hours, then you can ask for overtime pay. That is decided by state government. So that is another law, this another act this is talking about. So no work beyond 5 hours without interval for rest of half an hour. So minimum you will get at least 1.5 hours break. So how it is calculated is lunch is basically 1 hour, and 15 minutes is a break. 15 minutes break before the they can. So this depends on the companies, because nowadays if you see, they give tea breaks in the morning and they give tea breaks in the evening also. So it depends on the company or depends on the individual how they have to take about. But what is this means is, if you're starting your time by, if you're starting your work by 9 o'clock, so within 5 hours you have to take the next break, whatever it is, whether so basically the main break we're talking about is lunch break. So if you're starting your day by 9 o'clock, and within the next 5 hours you have to take your lunch break. So that's why generally in nowadays you see most of the companies, they give a break by 1 o'clock. So 5 hours means not post 5 hours, before 5 hours. That is what this law talks about. So that is one break that you can take. And another thing is there are another half an hour which is also break is there. So that break can be divided, maybe cut into 15 minutes, morning 15 and afternoon 15, or half an hour. So nowadays this is, so when I'm talking about these minimum, this I'm talking about minimum criteria that the company should follow. Some nowadays the company can exceed more than this, but at least minimum this has to happen in any company. So that is what this law is talking about. So as I already spoke about, if you are working for more than 9 hours, and also more if it exceeds more than 48 hours, then you get overtime pay. So either one of these, for example, if you are working, if you calculate every day, if you work for more than 9 hours, and if it exceeds more than 48 hours, then you have to get overtime pay. This is another important thing that the law is talking about. So for women workers who are working, they cannot work before 6 a.m. and after 7 p.m. What does this means is to protect women from the work. So what is this? Before 6 a.m. and after 7 p.m., those who are involved in hazardous process. So in a factory, there will be a lot of workers. So if you are involved in this one, before 6 a.m. and after 7 p.m., it is not allowed for you to work for women. So, and also it is not allowed for any person to work less than 14 to 15 years. So, if anyone is working, that is a crime. So, these are the working hours provisions that we just spoke about. So, let us go back. So we just touched upon the working hours. So what is the working hours that we'll be talking about? So now next one, we'll be going towards welfare provisions. anyone has any questions, can ask. Right? I don't have any questions, so I will move forward. So welfare provisions, what is this welfare provision? Is to protect the workers who are working. So basically another important aspect, main objective of this thing is also to provide safe and hygienic working environment. So washing facilities, separate and adequate washing facilities for both male and female has to be there, and it has to be separate. It has to be separate. So we'll be carrying a lot of clothes, so there has to be storing facilities separately for each worker. That has to be there maintained. Sitting facilities has to be there, and first aid appliances has to be there. So this is another important thing. When there are more than 100 workers working, for every 50 workers there has to be a first aid kit kept. It has to be certified. The first aid kits has to be certified, and provision for well-equipped ambulance room where more than 500 workers. If there are more than 500 workers, there has to be a ambulance room or a first aid room has to be there. If the workers crosses more than 500 in a factory or in an industry. So if there has to be canteen facilities provided, if there are more than 250 workers, so that has to be maintained. Restroom facilities has to be there. If there are more than 150 workers, and there has to be a restroom facilities, and for every 150 workers, there has to be a drinking water facilities has to be provided by the factory or a company. So if there are more than 30 women working in a company, then there has to be creches. What is this creche means is nothing but so if there are women, they might have a child, and to maintain the child, this creche facility will be set up. So then if there are more than 500 workers, there has to be a welfare officer. Welfare officers are nothing but if you have any issue, you can go and complain, or you can voice out your opinion with the welfare officers. So this is governed by the state government. So we move on to the next one, which is health and safety provisions. So clean and free from effluents. So the whatever it is, the working area and the working environment has to be thoroughly cleaned for every 3 hours. Disposable of waste effluents. This has to be maintained by the factories, because this creates a lot of issues for the environment and for the workers. So the waste is disposable treatment has to be maintained. So ventilation and temperature control equipments have to be installed. So in the factories, there has to be ventilation and temperature control machines has to be maintained in this in the factories. That is another important law that has been maintained. So the state government actually sends inspector to check about all these things. So this is another important thing that the company has to be keep in mind. Dust and fume, there are a lot of, in the factories or in industry, there is a possibility of a lot of dust and fume will be created, which will be very deadly for the workers. So there has to be dust and fume machines has to be installed. Artificial humidification is nothing but keeping the humidity under control. So the factories generally try to produce a lot of heat. So it is good to the artificial humidification, what it does is to it reduces the heat. That is the purpose of the artificial humidification. So that has to be installed. So there has to be a particular amount of workers in a particular room has to be maintained. Lighting facility has to be maintained. We already spoke about drinking water facility. And lateral urines has to be separate for male and female. It has to be washed at least every 7 days. Spittooms is nothing but to maintain hygiene. There is a place where you can use two spittooms. So these are the health provisions. Next, we'll go into safety provisions. This is nothing but so lot of machineries will be there. This is also to protect machineries and also to provide any dangers for the workers. Young person, we already discussed, which is again prohibited in doing all this kind of work. When there is self-acting machines, there has to be a fencing around it. If there are, there has to be casing on all the machineries. And if there are any exit where there are any fumes that is coming out, no person should be worked on the end of that side. Hoist and lifts have to be maintained and it has to be thoroughly cleaned at least for every 6 months and it has to be sealed. Floors and the stairs can have to be quickly, every time has to be cleanly washed. So there has to be lifts when we are carrying heavy machineries. So there has to be a fire extinguisher has to be kept in the premises. And last but not the least, safety officers. Safety officers has to be there. Basically what is, this is during the any emergency, they are in charge to maintain the safety of the workers. So with this, we are coming to end of the Factories Act. So this is a very, very big act and there are a lot of provisions given, but I'm just pointing out a few of the things which are very needed for the ITI students. So not everything has been covered under this act, but this is what has been covered under curriculum and this is very basic and these are some of the things which you can keep in mind before when you go into any factory or worker or industry. Any questions? Okay, someone is asking, can you give examples of each section on health and safety? I will go back. So if you see, if you visit, if you have visited any factory or work floor, there will be a lot of possibility of for you to, there are a lot of dust will be created and a lot of noise will be created. So regularly they have to be cleaned. So which lets you to avoid any injuries. So that is why this has been maintained. So disposable of waste and effluents. So what happens is when you dispose waste and effluents, it can be dangerous for the environment and also for the workers who are working, not only inside the factory, but also the surrounding area. That will be very dangerous because that will create a toxic impact on the society. So what has government has done is to, when you are disposing of any waste, you have to treat it first, then only dispose. So that is a main criteria that government has given to avoid any harmful effect on the environment and also on the worker. Ventilation and temperature. Basically, if you see, there is a lot of heat that has been created in the factory floors. So so that's why this ventilation, basically temperature control machines are also installed in the floors where to avoid any dangers for the environment and also for the workers. Dust and fume is basically, as we already spoke, it will create a lot when you're producing any raw materials, it creates a lot of dust and fumes. So to that, when you inhale those things, it will create a lot of health hazards. So to avoid this one, dust and fume machineries has been installed in order to safely protect the workers who are working under this dangerous process. We already spoke about artificial humidification, basically to reduce the humidity in the workshop. Yeah, we already spoke about all these things. So nowadays, if you see work, if you visited any factory floor, you will find a lot of spittums. Spittums is nothing but small place where you can spit instead of spitting here and there, which will avoid, which is really dangerous. And also nowadays, you see the need of this spittums. So these are initiated by government. If you see this Factories Act, it is as old as our independence. So the government saw the need of this Factories Act. That's why it is initiated at that time. So there's a lot of cases where if there is no fencing, it leads to a lot of injuries. To avoid all those things, this has been done. And also nowadays, if you see, there is also a lot of sensors which has been installed in the machineries, which basically try to avoid all any injuries that might lead to the workers. Any other question? Okay. So, if there are any more questions, I would like to answer, or else we can move on to the next law. This Provident Fund. So, I don't know how many of you have been working, but generally when you are working, as soon as you get salary, when you get something called payslip, in your payslip, there is something called, they will deduct some amount for XYZ reasons. One will be the Provident Fund, PF. Then the other could be another, could be ESI. Then there could be other professional taxes. So we'll be talking about PF. What is this PF and how does it help you as a worker? So let's go into that. So basically, this law has been come into place to protect the workers. Basically, it's like a savings account for all the workers. It is compulsory for all the employees who are working, who are come under this law. So this, who's eligible? Every employee who's employed directly or through a contract who is getting wages from the company will go under this law. So minimum of 10% is the PAF cut, and maximum of 12% is the PAF will be deducted from your basic salary. So from your basic salary, not from your total salary. For example, if you are getting 10,000 is as a salary, as a basic pay, from 10,000 will be the deduction. So that will be 12%. So let's, in order to understand this, let's take an example. I just taken a sample of the payslip of some company. Let's imagine this is a ABC Company Limited, and all this is how you will get a payslip. So let's imagine you have basic salary, then DA, then all these things and total amount. This is gross salary and this is your net salary. And these are your all your deductions. Deductions are the why the reasons that they cut salary. So if you see 15,000 is the per month the salary, and this company is deducting 12% of the PF, 1,800, which just comes around 12%. And from this 12%, which should be added to the employee's PF account. So you will have also, you will get a PF account number. With that PF account number, you can every month the company will put. For example, from you, you'll get, you'll be deducted 1,800, and the company will also put equal amount. For example, if you are deducted 1,800, the company will also put 1,800 in your PF account, which you can withdraw after you cross certain age group, and there are some criteria. For this, if you want more information, you can go to PF office or PF website and look for more information on this. So basically, that is what it is. And end of the day, you can take back most of the amount, whatever your whatever there it is deducted from your salary. So if you see in this, from only from basic, it has been deducted, not from the overall, not even not from the net or not from the gross salary. It's only from the basic salary, which has been which will be deducted. So 12% is a contribution from the employee and 12% from the contribution of the employer. So 12% from the employee will go to the pension scheme and also for other things. So how does it benefit as a worker? Employees can take advances, withdrawal from PF in case of retirement, medical care, housing. If you have any emergency like retirement, medical care, housing, if you're for education of your children or something, you can withdraw some amount of that amount from your PF account. Up to 90% amount can be withdrawn at the age of 54 years before 1 year of actual retirement. So if you are around your 54 age, you can withdraw more around 90% of your PF amount. If anything happens to you, either that amount will or can be withdrawn by your nominees, your children, your wife, husband, also. Equal, we already spoke about this. Whatever is your contribution to your PF account, equal contribution will be given by the company where you are working. So it is always good to see what is every month, what is the amount that has been deducted from you. And you can take a look at your PF statement for that. Currently, it is 8.6%. This might change. So based on the economy. So yeah, PF account can be transferred if employee, for example, there's a case where if you are shifting from one company to another company, and what happens to the PF account? So that there are two things that you can do. One is you can withdraw the amount. Another thing is you can also transfer the account. For example, if you're going to company A to company B, from company A, you'll have 123 as a number. You can go to company B. You can give 123 as this is my PF account number, and you can follow the same thing. You can just transfer the amount from one company to the another company. For this also, you can go to the PF account, EPFO website, and go get more information on this. So with this, we are done with PF Act. Any questions? Okay, thank you so much. I have got a question. Yeah. So basically, it is calculated.
Hello.
So 12. So basically, it is 12% of the of your salary. It depends on the company you are working. So yeah, basically, if you take your base salary, sorry, basic salary, I'll just go back to the pay statement. If you see this imagine this is a basic salary, which is 15,000. And basically what it is divided by 12% into 100. So 12%. So that is a basic formula you can keep in mind to calculate your PF account, PF amount. So yeah, that is a basic thing. And when employer contribution goes, it will be divided. Not everything they'll put. There are two type of thing that you'll get. If the employer contributes, it will go to your retirement benefit, and also it will go to your PF amount. So it is divided. So that is a calculation, basic calculation that you can keep in mind when you are calculating PF. Okay. Thank you. So if you want any more information, you can log on to bharatskills.gov.in.